नेहा मैडम एंड गुड मॉर्निंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू. दिस इज रियाद हुसैन एंड आई एम गोइंग टू टेक द ऑपरेटिंग सिस्टम पार्ट. आई एम गोइंग टू एक्सप्लेन सम बेसिक ऑपरेशन, मीन्स हाउ ऑपरेटिंग सिस्टम्स दे आर वर्किंग फॉर कंप्यूटेशन प्रोसेस, हैंडलिंग डिफरेंट काइंड ऑफ ऑपरेशंस. And so basically in operating system lecture, there is a three segments. So on the first two segment, we're going to deal with the theoretical parts of Windows, Linux, some theoretical concept. We try to understand them. And on the last segment, in the last session, means I think it started from 1:45. At that moment, we are going to deal with some practical part. Means how Windows and Linux basically they are installed using the virtual box. Okay, so just let's get started. So just for proper visuality, I'm going to turn off my video and for concentrating on my screen. So just 1 second. Okay, before started, I just want to share something with you that this course is means this training is all about the cyber security, means protecting our data, our information from online threats like viruses, hackers, during email or transferring information from one node to another node. But operating system is basically a master software who plays very important role for computation or processing. So before understanding the security and the threats and different kind of concepts about the cyber security, so first of all we need to understand about some our master software who handle everything properly. So that's why I want to start it from this part, from the very beginning, from the scratch part. So I think all of you seen this part contents and started from what is a computer, means from the basic part and origin of computer, types of computer, computer system structure, what is an operating system, layers of an operating system, generation, functions, types, brands, advantage, disadvantage, that's all. So, okay, so first thing first, what is a computer? So this is our first term. So just a computer have some brief description, but if you look today's computer, this is basically an electronic device which have some hardware components like keyboard, mouse, monitor, and CPU, central processing unit. Okay, about the today's computer, but basically this is just a word. Computer is a word, it's a name, it's not defined that, it's not defined that there is some hardware components, electronic components, monitor should be there, CPU should be there, not like this. So the term computer is derived from the word compute. You can see this compute. Compute means the calculation. So computer was originally defined as a super fast calculator. So there is a full form of computer, that is common operating machine, particularly used for technical entertainment and research, the full form of computer. So if we talk about the today's computer, so what it can do? Process the data according to specified rules. We are giving input. We are giving input to the computer because computer is a machine. So machine don't have ability to do something by its own. So user should give some input. That is the input part. And computer have something, some hardware parts, some software parts, they work together to process our instruction and give some output. So this is the computing part, processing part. This is input given by user. So just like I am sharing my screen, so this is also an input. I am drawing something using paint tools. This is also input. So computer is processing and gives some output. And the most important thing is the computer can store information for future use. That is all about the memory. So there is a different kinds of memories we are using in computer, like primary memory or main memory, we can say, like RAM, ROM, cache. That kind of memory is called primary. Secondary memory means externally connected to the computer, like hard disk, pen drive. They all are the secondary memory. And there is another term that is called virtual memory. Virtual memory is actually not existing physically. It's a term. There is some situation where the virtual memory actually comes and shows some extraordinary things. So there is a three types of memory. Okay, so moving to the next slide. Just 1 second. Okay, origin of computer. So just like as I told that, computer does not define that there should be some hardware components, there are some softwares, and not like this. Computer is a term, it's a word, comes from computation. So basically, the first computer was abacus. So this is the pictorial form of abacus. This is the first computer. Computer, there is basically three generation means there is a three categories in computer. The first computer was simple frame, means using some entities or object like some rods, beads are there. You can see on the abacus picture. And after that, after so many development, there is a mechanical computers, means machine components used. They are designed by extraordinary scientists like Pascal, Napier, Charles Babbage. Then after that, electronic computer. So abacus was basically a frame computer. There was no any electronic components. There is no any mechanical machine component. There is no any wires, plugs, software, monitors, nothing. It was a simple frame. But this frame is actually used for calculation purpose. So there is some algorithm. Algorithm means some procedure, some rules, how to calculate or perform some arithmetic or calculation on the abacus. So this thing was comes before thousands of years, means approximately 2400 BC before Christ on China. And after that, abacus was modified by different kind of civilization. Abacus was modified. So why abacus is called a computer? Because maybe somehow you have the question that why abacus is a computer? Because it don't have any operating system. It don't have any mouse, keyboard, nothing is there. So computer is basically about the process of computation. Whatever the thing we are using for calculation or computation means performing mathematical operation. So they are called computer. But there is actually two terms, partial computer and perfect computer. Partial means only performing the mathematical operation. And the perfect computer means mathematics plus logic, logical operation. Okay, so this is the origin. And next thing, okay, just let me erase this inks. Okay, so this is about the mechanical part, means how Charles Babbage designed the computer architecture, means the modern day computer architecture, that is called analytical engine. Means after abacus, civilizations improved, they researched about so many things, and some scientists were come, like Napier. Napier was invented a mechanical device for calculating multiplication and logarithm of natural numbers. That machine is actually called Napier Bones. And then Pascal, Pascaline machine, that is for addition and subtraction. Then on 1822, before 19th century, 1822, Charles Babbage designed a mechanical device that is called difference engine. Then after that, modified the difference engine to the analytical engine on 1833. So on that machine, the input of programs and data was to be provided to the machine via punch card. Punch card, that is just like some giving input techniques, like our connecting our pen drives, CD, DVDs for giving some data information or giving some inputs. So just like the punch card was used. For output, the machine would have a printer, a car plotter and a bell. So these are the input and output form. The machine would also be able to punch numbers onto cards to be read in letters. So basically that machine, I am talking about, that is analytical engine, that machine actually don't have any storable part, because the storing concept actually introduced at the time of 1945 by von Neumann. Means the stored program architecture, stored computer architecture. But before that, before 1945, there was computer. We can calculate so many operation, arithmetic operation. But there is no such kind of terms like memory, primary, secondary. We can store our program, instruction, data. Then we can process them, execute them by the microprocessor. Okay, memory was absent. Real-time processing was there. So this is about the... Means actually in today's computer, why Charles Babbage is actually called the father of computer. There is a reason, because in our today's computer, our computer architecture, means how our motherboards are designed, that is actually the integrated form of analytical engine. So lots of things are improved and changed, but the basic architecture, means how different parts are connected with each other. So if you want to know about this, you can see your own motherboard of computer. Motherboard means wire, means our hardware components. If you are using the laptop, then just bottom of your keyboard, there is one circuit, electronic circuit, that is called motherboard, which contains so many hardware components, like processor, RAM, then different kind of capacitors, transformers, power coils, so many things up there. So this is basically the integrated form of analytical architecture. So that's why Charles Babbage is called father of computer. But actually, truly, there was another scientist called Alan M. Turing. He was born in the year of 1913 around and died in the year of 1953 or 54, Alan M. Turing. So most of the computer scientists, they considered Alan M. Turing is the, means the purest father of computer, because he gives very extraordinary things to the computer science. Okay, so not lesser than Charles Babbage. Okay, so that's why there is a two controversy about the Charles Babbage and Alan M. Turing. Who is actually the father of computer? So what Alan M. Turing doing is, Alan M. Turing basically introduced an algorithm that is called the computable numbers. The computable numbers. Computable number. Okay, so this is an algorithm. This was an algorithm. You can find on this algorithm on the Google, because it have one journal published. So this was published on 1935. So algorithm is basically some step-by-step way to solve a problem. Algorithm. Basically, I'm going to discuss this later. In computer science, there is a three way to solve a problem. One is algorithm, another one is flow chart, and the third one is the program or using the instruction. So these three of them are basically called the theme of computer science. Algorithm is basically step by step way to solve a problem. Suppose you ask me that I want to go to the Delhi. Delhi gate. How do I reach there? Suppose you are new in Delhi. So then I'm just guiding you that step one, you just go outside of your hotel. Then step two, take some vehicles, transport vehicles. So this kind of explanation, so this is also the solution of your problem. But not the exact solution. Exact solution will be done when you reach to the our Delhi gate, India gate. So, but this is also the solution. So this kind of solution is called the algorithm. So LLM Turing designed an algorithm, and that algorithm have so much power, just like today's supercomputers have. So LLM Turing algorithm was named is the computable numbers. And he also credited for the idea about the automatic computing engine, or today we are calling this artificial intelligence or electronic brain. So for this reason, he was honored by the Nobel Prize at 1937 something. So this algorithm is actually used inside our microprocessor, because each and every machine have some rules to do some operation. Because if we look into our fan, every mechanical electronic component, each and every machine, even in the pendulum clock, they also have some oscillation. In physics, that is called oscillation, means pattern of a machine to do something. So microprocessor also have some pattern to process or executing instruction. So that pattern or that algorithm is basically comes from the Turing algorithm, by which microprocessor calculating or executing the instruction. So that is all about the Charles Babbage, means how mechanical computer comes at 1833. That is an analytical engine. Then after that, okay, so let me erase this part. So now the types of computer. Okay, so we are moving from frame computer to Charles Babbage mechanical computer. Then now, step by step, we are reaching to our today's computer, means electronic computer. So computers can be classified in a number of different ways, by architecture or by size or purpose. Different types of computers are there. By architecture, there is analog, digital, hybrid, Harvard, von Neumann, complex, means CISC and RISC, complex instruction set computer, reduced instruction set computer. And by size, there is supercomputer, just like our Param, then mainframe computer, mini computer, so many types. Okay, so these all are the types of computers. Okay, so the next thing is, this is about the today's computer, modern day computer. Computer system structure. Computer system can be divided into four components. One is hardware, then operating system, then application program, then users. Okay, so hardware means just like our input-output device, means keyboard, mouse, monitor, printer, they all are the hardware components. And our microprocessor, memories, graphics card, everything. Then the operating system. Operating system is the master software. Okay, see, the basic architecture of a computer is computer, who done the computation? Hardware parts, means microprocessor. Microprocessor executing all the instruction, mathematical or logical instruction. Okay, so that is the microprocessor. We are calling this CPU. On CPU, there is actually three. Mainly, there is a three segments. One is control unit, then arithmetic logical unit, and there is some register. resistor. Okay, so this is the CPU, central processing unit, or the small IC that is called microprocessor. Just today, different versions are there, like dual core, then i5, i7, so many things are there, microprocessor types. So inside the CPU, there is control unit, arithmetic logical unit, resistor. Okay, so resistors, they are basically some local memory of CPU. They are small in size, but they are very fast, means read write operation performed in very fast manner. So that's why this is the most fastest memory in the computer. They are small in size. Okay, so they are faster than RAM, cache, even hard disks. Resistors are the fastest memory. So there is a reason why resistor is the fastest memory. The first point is the size is very small, and the second point is they are very close to the CPU, because CPU is the most important hardware components who done all the execution, perform all the calculation, and giving you the output. CPU is the main part, and all other parts, the support to do that execution. They have some different responsibilities. Memories, they have the responsibilities to store data and instruction, and your after executing the output. And keyboard, mouse, they have the responsibility for transferring the instruction from user to the computer. And output device have the responsibility for transferring output to the user, from computer to the user. But the actual thing, this is just like our college or organization director, CPU. So many employees are there, but actual thing, decision, and everything is handled by properly our director, sir, or if in our college point of view, the principal or director, that is CPU. So arithmetic logical unit, this part is actually handling all the mathematical and logical operation. Whatever we are doing in our computer, inside that, there is a two kinds of operation. One, it's maybe mathematical, or maybe some logical or information processing. So that thing is actually done by ALU part. So how ALU handle them? Because ALU is an electronic component which have so many circuit gates are there. Okay. Resistor is the local memory. Means all the instruction and data, they first stored on the resistor. And after that, control unit, this is the control unit. Control unit decide that when should the instruction and data transfer to the ALU for execution. Then they transfer to the ALU, and they perform the calculation and making some output. Then that output again restored on the resistor, some resistor. Then from there, decided where this output will be transferred, on monitor, on printer, on any output device. So this is CPU. And what is the actual role of operating system? Operating system is basically a software. Not like software, this is a packet of so many softwares, operating system. Okay, see, the actual process, there is hardware part and we are the user. So we are giving instruction to the hardware, then hardware performs some operation and giving us the output. This is the actual logic of computers. Computation handled by the hardware components, and user given the instruction. So simple structure is there. But there was a problem. The problem is hardware. Hardware, who are the hardwares? Electronic component. So electronic component, they only understand the states, means presence of electron or absence of electron. Just like we consider them as a 0, 1. 0 means none, no electron. 1 means on, means there is electron. But actually, at the point of view of electronic components, they only understand the states. The transistor, they have transistor, capacitor. Are there electrons inside the transistor or inside the capacitor, or there is no electron? We represent them by 0, 1, by true, false, by enable, disable. But hardware is only understand the state. Okay, just like our tube light. Tube light, then bulb, our fan, So they are also electronic device. So electronic device, they have simple language, that is states, presence or absence. If there is electron, then they have some state. If there is no electron, they have some different state. Like bulb will be on, bulb will be off, that kind of thing. So hardware only understands. So that thing is actually called the metallic language, means all the electronic components, they're built by some metal, metallic language, or sometimes we call this machine code, machine understandable form. But we are the user, we are the human being. We only understand just like Hindi, English, Bengali, this kind of languages. So there is two entities, one is hardware, another one is user. They both of them want to communicate with each other, but they have different language. So how this communication is possible? This is not possible because hardware only understand machine code, and we are only understand just like natural real life languages like our mother tongue, our national language, Hindi, English, this kind of things. So that's why we need someone who plays as a translator. We need someone in between hardware and user part. Okay. So in this middle part, yes, there is some translator, just like compiler, interpreter, assembler, so many translators are there. Compiler, interpreter, and assembler. They are actually converting user understandable form to the hardware form. And after executing by the microprocessor, when there is some output generated, obviously that output is in the machine code form. So that is again retranslated to the user form and transferred to the output device. Then we can see, okay, 2 + 2 = 5. So this middle part, there is not only translator. Translator is not only the solution. So many things we need. So that all the things are given by the master software. So now the architecture have changed little bit changed. Okay. So now in computer architecture, there is a three layer: hardware, who done the actual execution, user, who given the instruction, what to do, then software, who performed, means as an interface between hardware and user. We are given instruction to the software. Software process it, convert it into the machine form, then transfer to the hardware. Hardware execute that, then giving us the output. Again, output received by the software, then retranslate into the user form, and we can see our output. So this software is actually the operating system. Operating system is just like a packet which contains so many applications, so many softwares. Just like right now, most of we are using Windows operating system or Linux operating system or Mac operating system. So operating system is basically a packet which contains so many applications, so many softwares are there, like translator, linker, loader for different services. For our desktop program, for our start menu, for each and everything, there is some system softwares, means operating system. They have all other small application for its services. Operating system. So control and coordinates use of hardware among various applications and users. So that is the main thing. What is the role of operating system? It's basically create or make the interface in between user and hardware. Because without operating system or without the software part, this is very difficult for us to give some instruction in the form of machine code. Yes, there was some computers where actually this architecture was there. Only this architecture. We have to give the instruction in the form of machine code. This was very difficult. Just like our car, our bikes. We have to control all the things manually. We have to give instruction manually. So this is very important to remember or know about the functionality of the all components. Otherwise, this is not possible to drive a car. to drive a bike. So just like this. But now the machine handling concept, machine handling part is actually done by operating system. So just like right now we are using our Cisco video conferencing software, then I'm sharing my screen. So everything right now we are using. So that is the best example, means we are not actually know about, this is not compulsory to know about that screen sharing technique. Screen sharing technique is actually right now, what is the state of this process? Means how much, when I have to stop this, means everything is done graphically, means in the form of software, with the help of software, means operating system or some application software. So interface is more flexible and more friendly. Okay, so after comes this architecture of computer. So what we learn about the operating system, this is the master software. The main role is to make the interface between user and hardware. And there is some other functionalities also. We will learn step by step. Okay. And now third point is application program. Application program means, okay, see, the operating system is basic. There is the two types of software actually. One is system software, another one is application software. One is system software, then another one is application software. Application software, two types of software. System software means they are very important to run our system. Means without operating system, this is not possible to run or turning on our computer, do some task, not possible. So they are called, means operating system have so many software like translator, linker, loader, so many things are there. So each and every one is called system software because they are very important to communicate with the system. Without them, we are not able to communicate with the computer properly. The application software means there are some third party, means they are not actually system software, means they are not properly responsible to communicate with the system. They are using for some specific task, just like if I want to write some documents, then I'm going to install MS Office, MS Word, Excel. Okay, if I want to play some videos, some media files, video software, we are going to install. Okay, so for this video meeting, I have installed this software. Okay, so they are using for some specific task, just like WebEx. For this video conferencing. So the question is, if there is no any MS Office, any media player, any WebEx in my computer, so is there any chances that computer will not turning on, computer will not processing properly? No. Only that kind of operation we are not able to do. But computer will run smoothly. We can perform some other operation. We can write something on Notepad, which is a system software, comes with the Windows operating system. Okay, so there is no any, means some foundation that MS Office should be there inside your computer. If you need this, you can install this. They are not responsible to make interface, the actual connection in between user and hardware. So that's why they are called application software. Means we sometimes we can call them utilities. And the fourth component is user, because obviously, okay, application software, actually, they are not interacting with the hardware, application software. Hardware interaction actually handled by the operating system, and operating system have one core programming, means operating system basically have two layer, one is shell, another one is kernel. So kernel is the main part of operating system, kernel. So that kernel part handle all the hardware interfacing part. Means which software need the hard disks, which software need the RAM, microprocessor. Kernel actually handle this thing. Means all the application software, they depend on the operating system depend on the operating system of kernel of operating system for communicate or use some hardware components just like keyboard, mouse. They are not able to use them directly. They are not responsible. Kernel is the responsible. Okay, thank you. So these are the four parts, computer system structure. Hardware, definitely. Hardware is the most important thing. Just like we have learned that microprocessor, RAM, hard disks, then keyboard, mouse, monitor, they all are the hardware components. Operating system plays very important role because this is the master software which make the connection or create the interface in between user and hardware. Means we are actually communicate with the hardware through the operating system, not directly. Okay, so this is the operating system. Operating system have so many functionalities, we will learn them later. And the third one is called application software. Those are used for some specific task. They are not very much important to communicate with the hardware. Then fourth one is user, means people. There could be some machine or other computers. So in this part, user part, don't get confused. People, machines, other computers means maybe some machine, just like server. Server, they are also machine, but they have the ability to process our query and give some reply. Okay, so there are some machines, they have some ability to give input to the other machine. So that's why people, machine, other computers. Okay. Okay, so lots of things are there. I will try to cover them as much as possible. Okay, I'm going to erase these things. Okay, see, in brief, the architecture is computer components. They looks like this. Okay. So see, user 1, 2, 3, 4, means up to nth. Nth number of user. Then there is a compiler, assembler, text editor, so many software things are there. System and application programs, they are present in this section. Operating system means, operating system is basically the main part, means the kernel and the computer hardware. So we are actually exist here. We are the user. We used translator. Definitely we need translator, na? Because each and every instruction we are given to the computer, they are not in the machine code, but computer understand the machine code. We are giving them by using some languages. They are called programming language. In real life, suppose if you want to communicate with some other person, then what kind of language we are using? We are using our mother tongue, Bengali, Hindi, English, just like this. Na? So we are giving the instruction using some languages in computer. In computer, when we try to communicate with the computer, so not English, not Hindi, not Bengali. There is some other languages are used. They are called programming language. So we are given instruction through the programming languages, just like C, C++, this kind of language. Then there must be some translators, some other softwares are there who translate them. And we are basically write our code, compile them using some system and application programs are there. And after finally convert it into the binary form, binary code of our given instruction. I will explain this thing. What is binary? What is user understandable? What is some kind of object code? This kind of thing. So first of all, we are giving instruction using some programming language. They're translated by the translator. See, yeah, there is translator who stands here. Then some system and application programs are there. Okay. Then they transferred it to the operating system. Then operating system kernel received them. The kernel is the main part. Who actually communicate with the hardware? None of the other, any kind of application, any kind of operating system software, no one is there except kernel who connect with the hardware components. So each and everything, whatever the things, that thing is actually given by us or some other software or anything, any machine, any computer. After so many steps, the transfer to the operating system kernel, then kernel verified that instruction and passes this instruction to the proper hardware components, to the RAM or to the CPU, that is decided by the kernel. Okay, the kernel communicate with the computer hardware. So these are the steps. Okay, see, the next thing is now the, our main point is what is an operating system? A program, operating system is basically a program or collection of program that acts as an intermediary between a user of a computer and the computer hardware. Definitely. You can see in this section, in this diagram. There is a user, software, hardware. Hardware done the actual execution, user given the instruction, but without operating system, nothing is possible, because none of the instruction will be translated to the machine code. If instruction are not translated to the machine code, then how they are understandable by the microprocessor. So they need to be translated to the machine code, then transferred to the proper hardware components, then step by step they reach on the CPU, then CPU execute them, and we are receiving the output. So OS is there. Operating system goals: execute user programs and make solving user problems easier. Make the computer system convenient to use. Use the computer hardware in an efficient manner. Definitely. Okay, definitely. Operating system, without, just think about this. In your computer, there is no any operating system. There is no any operating system. There is hardware components are present. So if you want to do some arithmetic calculation, then you have to give instruction manually. Just think about this. How this process, how you going to make this thing? How complex it will be without operating system. Okay, so this is the efficient manner we are communicating with the hardware components. If you want to expand the diagram, this diagram, then you can find this diagram. User, we are giving instruction using some application software. Okay, just right now we are giving some video calling. We are running some video calling operation. So operation is actually handled by the microprocessor, right? So, but now we are using WebEx for video calling. So this is application software. So we are using WebEx, and WebEx don't have any connection with the CPU. WebEx have connection with the operating system kernel, then kernel connected with the hardware, then our video calling is operated. So that is the thing. Layers of an operating system. Okay, so if this layers is complex to you, then just in simpler way, operating system, they have, it have only two layers. Just try to understand this thing. The inner layer is called the kernel. Kernel. And the outer layer, to protect the kernel, there is shell. Shell. Okay. So don't think about this. This layer, is it only for Windows? This is for any operating system. Operating system, the main part is kernel. Okay, kernel, which have connection with the different hardware components. Okay, kernel have connection, or it have the privilege to access different hardware components. That is the kernel. And kernel have so many other responsibilities also. And one important thing is, kernel is basically a program. Kernel is basically a program which is designed by mostly C language. Kernel, very important thing, right? Of operating system, this is the most important thing. So kernel is actually designed by mostly by the C language, and some of the codes, they are on assembly language. Okay, so there is so many types of programming languages are there. Each and every one have some specific purpose. They have some special form, special use. Okay, so that's why so many languages are there. So assembly code is basically intermediary code, means they are not properly high level. They are not properly machine level. They are present in the middle form, assembly code. So kernel is actually designed by mostly C or assembly. Kernel is designed to protect this kernel, because kernel handling some very important things, right? So we have kernel should be protected by very secure things, that is shell. Shell is the protecting layer of kernel. That means whatever, suppose we are user, right? We are here. We are giving instruction to using some application software, like WebEx, Google Chrome, something like this. We are giving instruction. Then application software, from application software, that instruction first received by the shell. First received by the shell. Then shell first verified this, filtering this, checking the security. Is this instruction means, is there any viruses or some ohms? Is there something which is very dangerous to the kernel? Shell will filtering this thing. And after verifying, if this all are okay, then shell transferred this instruction to the kernel. Then kernel decide that ki this instruction, what it's about, means how it's going to be converted to the machine code. Kernel have some programs to convert the binary form to the machine code. Then kernel transferred that machine code finally through the shell to the RAM memory. RAM, random access memory, right? Main memory. Because kernel have the connection with the hardware components, right? So kernel transferred that machine code to the RAM, and from RAM that is somehow transferred to the CPU, then CPU perform the execution. And again, the output again transferred to the RAM, from RAM the output received to the kernel, kernel transferred to the shell, shell to application software, application software to our output device, like our monitor. Suppose we are giving instruction 2+2. So 2+2 is only user understandable form, right? This is not understood by the machine. Machine is not understanding 2+2. What is 2+2? They only understand the state, machine code. So after so many steps, when CPU received 2+2, then perform the addition, calculating the addition result, that is in our form, that is 4. Then CPU replied that machine code of 4, then kernel received, then shell, application software, then they converted to 4 and print on our screen. So now just like this, we are getting our result. So this is the kernel, and shell is the protective layer. Kernel is very secured. Okay, so the next thing is generation of operating system. I'm going to remove this, all this paint. Operating system also have some generation. Okay, so today we are using very advanced operating system, right? Windows 10, Ubuntu version, means Linux 20.04, something like this, Mac operating system. So first of all, we should know about the history of the operating system. First generation operating system, 1940 to early 1950s. So I'm going to give this all PPT documents for your reference after the class. You can get this from the proper authority. Okay, so the first generation is 1940 to early 1950s, when the first electronic computer was developed in 1940 by IBM. Okay, so created without any operating system. There was no any operating system. Okay, users have full access to the computer machine and write a program. Each and means machine language. User should give the instruction manually. Means for addition, some operation, we have to on that gate for receiving the 2, and we have to on another gate, means turning on off, just like our electronic board for turning on of our light fan, just like this. We have to on that, 2 is transferred, then we have to off that bus, something like this. So this is very difficult thing. Okay, so the programmer can perform and solve only simple mathematical calculation during the computer generation, and this calculation does not require an operating system, because operating system, the important role is basically create the interface in between user and hardware. But right now, user is directly communicate with the hardware, so operating system is not required, right? So this was the first generation. On the second generation, you can study, you can study briefly, okay. So the second generation, 1955 to the 1965. On second generation, the first operating system was created in the 1950s, GMOS, General Motors. okay, by the IBM. Okay, so in the second generation. Second generation operating system was based on a single stream batch processing system. What is batch? We are going to see that. What is batch processing system? Because it collects all similar jobs, groups, so this kind of lots of things are there. In the third generation, multi-programming concept was trending topic, means research topic, multi-programming. Okay, but there is no any supportive operating system was there because only one operating system was GMOS, General Motors. Then in between this, means just like at the time of 1980s or early 1980s, our Windows, means Microsoft operating system, Apple operating system, they comes. I have explained them on the next slide. In the fourth generation means 1980 to the present day, the first operating system was MS-DOS, means Microsoft Disk Operating System, which comes in the year around 1980-1981. So, but MS-DOS was not Windows operating system. Okay, so there is difference. MS-DOS and Windows. MS-DOS was the first. So today we are using Windows 10, Windows 8, right? So they are called Windows. But the first operating system designed by Microsoft, that is MS-DOS. MS-DOS. Okay. Microsoft Disk Operating System in 1980-1981 at that time. And along with this, Steve Jobs comes with the Macintosh, okay, at the time of 1980s, okay, Apple software, okay. So these are the time when the operating systems are improving, means at the time of 1975 to that time. So there is actually a question. Question is, how these things are changed suddenly? Because, okay, so operating system is basically a software. To design a better software, we need a better programming language. So just like today we are designing artificial algorithm, machine learning algorithm. Just like you are searching some content on the Amazon. Suppose you are searching for keyboard, then after that, when you visited some website, then that website have some Amazon ads and Amazon only show you the keyboard advertisement. So how these programs, how these websites know about my choice? So there is actually some machine learning or some artificial codes are defined, some algorithms are defined. So today, this was the research topic. So overall, to design a better software, we need some better programming language. But you know, the 1970 and 72, when our first complete, the most favorable programming language was come, that is C language, designed by Dennis Ritchie. And before C, there was programming language like Fortran, Assembly, Pascal, Basic, Algol, BCPLB, so many languages are there. But C program is the perfect structured program. Means after C, these things, developing or changing the operating system, making the better software, better interfacing software in between user and hardware, this was possible. And graphical things, animation, games, they are actually comes to the proper effect after C. Then from C, C is changed to the C++ by Strostrup. Then at the time of after C++, around the 1989, Van Rossum developed the Python programming. Then 1995, James Gosling designed the Java programming. Then after that, okay, Java, lots of versions are there. So today we are using Android operating system, very advanced operating system. But Android operating system is basically Linux-based operating system. Android application designed by Java language, mostly Java and Kotlin. So that is the thing actually. Okay, after C, means after 1975, programming languages were developed. Means they become so much powerful. So that's why this operating system, MS-DOS, Apple, they are possible to create in such kind of form. Okay, see, function of an operating system. Function of an operating system is processor management. You can tell this process management also. Processor management or process management means in our computer. You see, in my computer right now, so many softwares are running. File Explorer, Google Chrome, VirtualBox, WebEx, PPT, then some Paint software. So many things are running. But you know that computer is basically depend on processing. Computer is two type actually. One is serial computer. One is let me write this thing. One is serial computer based on process. Okay, serial computer. Another one is parallel computer. Parallel computer. Okay, serial computer then parallel computer. So serial computer actually mean that means there is only one microprocessor is there, one CPU. Okay, so each and every process that transferred to the CPU line by line, just like ticket line. Okay, ticket line, line by line means my Google Chrome, Notepad, VirtualBox, lots of processes are running now, softwares are running. So you know that my computer is serial computer. It have only one microprocessor, single microprocessor. So if there is a single microprocessor, if on a ticket counter, if there is only one window is open, so how many lines will be there? Single line. So there is one CPU. So each and every process that comes one after another means line wise. So suppose this is my first process, that is WebEx. This is the second, Google Chrome. This is the third, Paint, just like this. So there is one CPU. So now the question is, if there is a single CPU and all the processes comes by a single line, then how my multiple processes are running? Because if we look into this diagram, when the WebEx process completed, then only Google Chrome comes to the CPU. Otherwise not possible, right? Because line by line manner, once the first process completed, then only the next process comes to the CPU. But if my laptop, my computer is serial computer, so how these different processes are executing together? How this different process? Anyone know about this? Just, this is not a question, just my concern. Is anyone know? Thread, okay. Okay, fine. Any more thing? Okay, fine. Thread is very important thing. Your answer is correct because of thread. Okay, but I want to add some more information there. Our computer is serial computer. There is single line for all the processes. Everyone should travel through that line and reach to the CPU. So that means one by one process will be executed. Means according to the rules of serial computer, when my WebEx application completed, means when I close this application, then I am going to able to open the Google Chrome. But you see, instead of closing the WebEx, I'm able to open the VirtualBox. I'm able to open the Notepad. Everyone is running, right? So that means there is one concept is applied, that is called pipelining. In serial computer, the concept is called pipelining. Pipelining. Yes, that is the concept of thread. Means this is the ability of operating system. This is not the ability of hardware. Very rich instruction level pipeline. Correct. So this is the concept of pipelining. Okay, serial computer, they have single processor. One time one process will be completed or handled by the CPU. Parallel computer means which have multiple microprocessor, multiple processor. So that means multiple processor means what? Multiple lines are there. So we can transfer different process to the different CPU. Okay. So parallel computer, definitely this is very much faster than serial computer. Parallel computer actually followed in some particular computer types like supercomputer, then mainframe computer, they use the parallel computing. They have lots of microprocessor. But in serial computer, so there is a drawback. Serial computer is the personal computer, right? PC, laptop. They have only one processor. So the drawback is very serious because there is only one CPU, one line, each and every process executed one after another. If I open Google Chrome, when I close Google Chrome, then I can only able to play a game. When I close that game, then I'm able to open other software. Means this is not possible to run 2, 3, 4 software simultaneously. So there is a two option. How to improve the processing speed of serial computer? There is a two option. First is improve the hardware components. First option, you purchase multiple processor, RAM, better hardware components. So it's required so much cost, expensive. And the second option is the hardware components, those are existing. You have already arranged them such a manner that the processing speed will be increased. That is by using pipelining. Definitely this is again the services provided by operating system. And this follows totally the thread processing. Okay. So see the process management is, I think you all of you have got this thing. Process management means using the pipelining module or algorithm, deciding which process will be transferred to the CPU for how many times and who will be the next. This kind of things are decided by the operating system. So that's why first function is process management. Next is act as a resource manager. Very important thing. Resource manager means, you see, right now in my computer, how many resources are there? One mouse, one keyboard, one monitor, one webcam, one microphone. Everything is single. So they all are the resource. I'm using WebEx, correct? WebEx. So to run this application, the requirement of this application is what kind of resources it's required? Keyboard, mouse, webcam, monitor, these resources are required. Simultaneously, when you opened Google Chrome or VirtualBox, this software is required the monitor resource also, keyboard also, mouse, pointer is moving there. So each and every operation, each and every process, each and every software, they require the resources of our computer. And this is the most important functionalities of operating system, that providing resource to the application. Whatever the application, what kind of resource it's required, just provide it. So that's why for this special functionalities of operating system, our computer is actually called virtual computer. So now there is a question, why this is virtual? Because everything is physically existing. Keyboard is existing, mouse, monitor, we can touch them. So why this computer is virtual? Because just like, this is a concept actually, just like I have one room and one of my friend is come. And I tell him that, don't feel shy. This is, you feel that this is your room. Each and every resource present in this room is only for you. You use them. So my friend is very happy. And after so many times, after some time, another friend is come. And I am telling the same thing to that person, to that friend, that this is also your room. Every resource is for you. You can use them. Okay, just understood this thing. So exactly this room is for whom? For none of them. All my friend, everyone feel that I am giving this room to them. anyone can use that kind of resource without any interference from outside. So just like operating system, when WebEx is running, operating system fill means this operating system actually tell the WebEx software that all the resource of this computer is only for you. You can use them. The monitor is for you, webcam is for you, microphone is for you, keyboard, mouse, everything is for just for you. There is none one. No one is there. So WebEx is very happy. WebEx use all the resources. Then when you just click on the virtual box, operating system just tell the same thing to the virtual box. The virtual box, all the resource is only just for you. Monitor, everything for you. When you open the Google Chrome, then the same thing again, tell to this operating system, tell to the Google Chrome. So now the question is, so all the resources of our computer, they are not only dedicated to a particular application. They are for everyone, every process. So that is called virtual computer. Means because in my computer, there is only single mouse, single monitor, but operating system represent this monitor to every process. That is for you, this is for you, this is only for you. So how many monitors are there? Single. So how operating system manage this thing? That's why our computer is called virtual computer, a logic. So this is one of the most important functionalities of act as a resource manager. Memory management. Okay, I'm just shortly explain this thing because time is very short. Memory management. We can manage, operating system manage the RAM, hard disks, ROM, cache, everything, every memory. Means which process right now loaded into the RAM, when the RAM memory should be freed or deallocated, that kind of thing. File management in our computer, different kind of file system we are using, text, PDF, Word file. So operating system manage them with different kind of extension. That is very easy for us to understand them or identify them. Security, definitely operating system provide the security, just like our antivirus, password protection, so many things up there. Device management, when we connect the pen drive or some other external device, peripheral device, then operating system manage this device, means connect this device to our CPU. Okay, then CPU understand that, okay, in this computer, there is another device is there, pen drive, and user can transfer data, read data from that device. Okay, so microprocessor. Know about them. Device management, input device and output device, definitely keyboard, mouse, monitor, okay, manage them. Deadlock prevention, okay, there is very important thing. Deadlock prevention, what is the meaning of deadlock? Deadlock actually means few times ago I was explaining about the virtual computer concept. Okay, at that moment when the WebEx is running, I just repeat this thing. WebEx is running, operating system tells the WebEx all the resources is for you. When Google Chrome you are opening, operating system tells everything is only for Google Chrome, just to every software. The same thing was repeated for all the software. So deadlock means there is actually fight in between two software about some resource. Suppose there is two software is running in your computer, two processes running actually. One process already reserved the monitor, already reserved. And another process who need the monitor resource right now. Okay, so suppose there is a two process A and B. A process already using resource one, you can consider any resource like a monitor, mouse, keyboard, anything. So this is the process using this resource. So now this process is required this R1 resource, but R1 resource is already held by some other process, right? Okay. But why this process A not releasing this resource for the B? Because A is already requesting for other resource also. is requesting for just like okay, let me clear this thing and draw the proper diagram. So this is our process one. Okay, process one. Request for a resource, that is R1. Okay, this is resource. And this resource is already reserved by some other process P2. Okay. So P1 is requesting for R1 resource, but R1 is already used by P2. Okay. So now the thing is, why P2 is not releasing this resource for P1? Because P2 is also requesting for resource, another resource, which is already reserved by P1. So this kind of things are actually happening. Just like our traffic signal, there is a four-way, four sides are there. Suppose this kind of roads are there. So if there is no any traffic management, then everyone comes to cross the road, wants to cross the road. So this kind of, but no one can able to reach their destination, because this thing will be stuck here, na? All the bikes, cars, traffic jams will be created. So this kind of thing. Process one requested for resource one for its completion, but resource one is already held by process two. So why process two is not releasing this? Because process two is requesting for resource two for its completion, but resource two is holding by the P1. So this cycle is infinite cycle. Okay. Sometime we are experience this thing that sometimes our computer hangs, okay, hangs, and the process are, do you want to wait or close the process? Because some kind of deadlock situation were created inside. When so many software, so many process you are running in your computer, then there is there is possibilities to generate the deadlock situation. More process, more management issues. Okay, operating system actually not able to manage all the resources to all the processes. If there is more process, then deadlock is created. Then time management, very important thing, time management. Operating system decide which process executed for how much time, and this kind of thing, this is time management. Coordinate with system software and hardware, definitely application software and hardware, and kernel. Okay, so this is WebEx. WebEx actually executed by the microprocessor, but by whom? With the help of operating system kernel, right? So these are the functions, okay, provided by our operating system. Okay, types of operating system. So there is some types like batch operating system. Okay, see, batch operating system. Okay, batch is actually some kind of, this is kind of a file, means you can consider this just like a process, means a process which is automatically executed without user interaction, means this kind of thing is actually called batch processing. The process who don't need the user interaction for execution, they are called batch processing. So some kind of batch operating systems are there, just like our in our ATM machine, when there is a screen up there, when you give some input, means giving the card, then ATM is actually doing the predefined things. Means there is no lots of things. We are not able to calculate addition, subtraction, multiplication. No, only the transaction operation. Okay, so after inserting the card, some program is executing automatically. Okay, executing, reading the card, CVV, something like this. Then after scanning all these things, if you are, some options will be visible, banking, balance inquiry, so many options are there. Then you choose one option, then after authenticating, means after giving the password, your unique identity, then after verification, you can withdraw or deposit some cash. So these machines have some operating system, definitely. But that operating system is doing the task which is already defined. Means there is no any user choice. Banking, if you choose the banking, only the banking operation will be there. There is no other options. Other choices are not there. Okay, that is not actually dynamic, static. So batch processing is automatically, means in batch operating system, there is no direct interaction between user and computer. Therefore, the user needs to prepare jobs and save offline mode to punch card or paper tape or magnetic tape. means without user interaction, the OS is doing its predefined instruction were given already. Time sharing operating system, the operating system which share the time, just like our computer, our laptop, our computer, the operating system, actually time sharing operating system means for different process, OS is actually sharing the time for management. That is actually called scheduling. Okay. So the next point, lots of topics are there, concepts are there. Embedded operating system. Embedded means the operating system is dedicated for some specific device, like our car, our microwave, our refrigerator, our television. There is also some controller, control software is there. But that software is only doing the specific specific task. Means in a washing machine, we are not able to give some instruction to cool something. Cooling something. This is not possible, right? So they are called embedded operating system, designed for some specific task. Multi-programming operating system. Again, this is our own personal computer, our desktop. This is the application. Multi-programming. We can concurrently we are processing multiple operation. This is the one of the most important function of OS. Advantage and disadvantage of operating system. Advantage, definitely it is helpful to monitor regulatory sources. Definitely. So now today's operating system has graphical user interface. Okay. So this operating system make the interface with the user and hardware, mostly using application software. The performance of computer system is based on the CPU. The response time and throughput time of any processor program are fast. Means multi-programming, we can process multi-programming, multi-threading, multi-operation, time sharing. Okay, process management, security, they all are the features, means advantage. It also offers a forum for various types of application like system and web application. Disadvantage, it allows only a few tasks that can run at the same time. There is a limitation, okay? If any error occurred in the operating system, the stored data can be destroyed, definitely. Stored data can be destroyed. It is a very difficult because in our hard disks, lots of data is up there. But if something has happened with our kernel, then you have to reinstall your operating system. Then all the data, everything will be erased. All the software, application software you have installed. Okay, so all will be deleted. It is very difficult task or works for the OS to provide entire security because this is not possible for the operating system to provide the proper security. Okay, there is some security. Means policies, security techniques are there, but not the much, because hacker and cracker, they are advanced, means they improve themselves day by day very faster way. An unknown user can easily use any system without the permission of the original user. Definitely in operating system, suppose I'm typing my password, so my friend is sitting just near by me, then I'm writing the password, he can observe this password, then after that he can able to write the password and log in and changing my data, computer data. Okay, so that is actually, that's why the biometric security means password protection, biometric technology comes. Okay, so biometric is also have some drawback. So there is a research is running how to protect our data, because in future hard copy means information, they all will be in the soft copy mode, means in computer, digitally, cloud, everything will be on online, means you all will be transmit through the internet, means in the digital. So this is very important to use some very high secured protection, you know, very password policies or to protect our data, otherwise all will be lost. Then popular brands on operating system, Microsoft, Windows, then Apple, Mac OS for Apple PC, desktop, then Google's Android operating system for our smartphone, for right now, different embedded system like television, they are also using Android, and the computer is also have the Android operating system. Apple iOS for iPad launched by the Apple, the software is iOS. Linux operating system, okay, Linux is also operating system for our personal computing and server side also. So these are the very most important operating systems are there. Okay, so this is my end of slide one, introduction to operating system, Windows and Linux. We will explain means I will explain briefly about them on the next slide. Okay, see. Okay, up to this, in this slide, is there any question anyone have? I think there is a lunch break, so actually 15 minutes are remaining, so I will try to cover some topics within this 15 minutes. Okay, so this is our next slide, next presentation. We can see, know your operating system, Windows and Linux. So we are actually learn about some basic means what is operating system, what is computer, what is the importance, functionalities, different brands. Okay, so now we are going to learn about the history of Windows and Linux. Okay, see, the history of personal computers began in 1977 earliest. Okay, I'm just making them in shortcut form. Windows history is actually just like on the previous slide, you have learned that the first operating system was MS-DOS, that is actually designed by Microsoft. Okay, Microsoft of that is the owner, chairman is Bill Gates. IBM is the International Business Machine. So IBM means 1980 approach at the time of 1980 before 1980 IBM approached to the Microsoft with a request that they need some operating system for their digital computers. Okay, so digital computer concept actually started from around the 1945 after the architecture introduced by George von Neumann. Stored program architecture means the concept of memory. Concept of memory actually involved with the architecture means a previous architecture of computer. Memory concepts were introduced. So after that, IBM research were developed like ENIAC, ENVAC, ADVAC. So many versions are there. Then IBM suddenly approached the Microsoft to design an operating system for their computer. Then just before that, Microsoft was only known for some developing some programming languages like basic B programming, Microsoft. Then after that, Microsoft started to develop the operating system. Then Microsoft called the operating system MS-DOS after giving the proposal by the IBM. The new operating system got the name MS-DOS 1.0. This was the first version. Microsoft this operating system. Okay, so see, the MS-DOS was look like this. I think all of you know about the CMD command prompt in our computer. So this is our CMD, or you can say the shell of operating system. Shell, this is the protective layer of kernel. We are actually in our computer in Windows, there is a two modes we can use for operating. One is a command mode, another one is graphical mode. Means we can create folder, we can create file, we can move them, we can execute any program, we can open my computer using graphical, means cursor, keyboard, just like this. And if you want to handle the computer using command, then you can use this CMD, command prompt. So MS-DOS looks like this. You can say this is the version or the form of MS-DOS. MS-DOS was the initial operating system which don't have any graphical user interface. There was no any button, any means option, drop down menu, radio button, nothing was there. Only command. If you want to do something, then you write command. So that was the MS-DOS, Microsoft Disk Operating System. MS-DOS was an operating system based on a simple communication between user and computer. Simple thing, simple interface. Okay, user entered commands, user entered commands on the screen using the keyboard as a mouse was used to a limited extent at this point. MS-DOS was the most common operating system for PCs before Windows. Okay, Windows and even MS-DOS, they are totally different. Today's operating system is called Windows operating system. But the initial operating system, MS-DOS, it was not Windows. This was Microsoft Disk operating system. So the first version of Windows, see, first version. The development of operating system with a graphical user interface started in the 1980s, which was when Microsoft decided to give MS-DOS a graphical user interface. See, this was the first operating system, and it only support command-based operation, right? You just think there is no any desktop, there is no any icons, nothing is there in your computer. When you turn on your computer, this is the first page of your computer, that is the screen of MS-DOS. So all the things you can do through this CMD part, writing the command. So see, this was not so easy, because we have to know all the commands for doing the things. We have to know how to create files, how to scan our computer, how to open my computer, how to open Notepad. It's just as an example. So lots of commands are there. So that was very difficult. So that's why abstraction process introduced. Abstraction means use something without knowing the background details. Just like, see in this WebEx, suppose, where is it? Okay, see, WebEx providing so many options are there, right? Huh? If I click on this, stop sharing, the sharing will be stopped. But now there is a question. Where is the command? Where is the instruction? Because computer only understand the instruction. But I'm not giving any instruction, right? Actually, the instruction is predefined. A instruction is already written inside this graphical thing. Okay, user will interact with the graphics. The graphics in the backbone, they have the instruction already written. When you click on this graphical button, actually the inner code, inner instruction translated, then step by step, they're going to the CPU, then CPU execute, then your screen sharing will be stopped. Okay, so what is this thing? This is called abstraction. Use something without knowing how it's going internally. So each and every software application, graphical application, they are actually providing abstraction process. Okay, so this is graphical user interface. So MS-DOS was not good, right? So it should be improved. So that's why Windows, Microsoft decided to give MS-DOS a graphical user interface. So then lots of user can use them, because now there is no need to remember the command, how to create folder. Just right click on your location, then go to the new, then create folder. Very simple thing. Microsoft created a graphical program for purpose called Windows. This is the graphical operating system. Means changing the MS-DOS to the graphical form. Windows 1.0 was the first version. 1983, it was released. And it was not, means it was very popular at that time. People, they are very, means interested, because this is graphical. So nowadays, this is very familiar to us, because each and every device, there is a graphical form. If you consider a watch, wristwatch, that is also a graphical form. But just think about the time of 1983. At that time, Windows, when the first version released, this is very extraordinary thing for the people. So this version, Windows 3.0, 1, 95, together they are actually called Windows 9X. All of them, they are actually called Windows 9X. Windows Millennium was released in the year of 2000. There is year are also mentioned. Then after that, Windows NT is come. NT means new technology, NT. NT means new technology. Computers acquired more and more memory, a higher processor speed and more disk space. Computer was improved, means upgraded. Hard disks improved, size was increased, RAM was increased, everything, every hardware configuration they improved. So at that time, operating system also needs some improvement, right? So that's why Windows NT come, new technology. MS-DOS could not handle a lot of memory. Windows software, Windows, the previous version of Windows, they are not actually able to handle lots of software application. They have some limitation, limited area, because they are the initial part of graphical user interface, right? So then Windows NT comes for the new system configuration. And those different kind of Windows versions are there. Windows NT versions. So these are the Windows NT version. You know that today's operating system, that is Windows 10, Windows 8, they are actually child of Windows NT. Windows 2000, XP, Vista, 7, 8, 10, everyone, they all are belong from Windows NT. So Windows 10 has become a shared platform known as One Core, and it runs on PCs, so many Xbox phones, Nokia phones, so many devices run Windows 10. Very popular. Okay, so I think it's 1 p.m. right now. So Neha madam, should I stop here and continue after the lunch?